Hi again and welcome. In this video, we'll have a better look at the HP ProDesk 600 G2 SFF, which I have here in front of me. During the video, as you probably could guess already by the title, I will disassemble this computer and reassemble it. While doing so, I'll also replace the hard disk with an SSD and upgrade the memory. Once all of that is done, I'll perform some basic benchmarks as well, so we know how this PC is performing. The HP ProDesk 600 G2 was also available in different form factors, from really small like this mini desktop to a tower version with more expandability and even an all-in-one. For today, I have the small form factor, probably the most popular version, not too big and not too small. A first look at the machine shows us a clean look, not even a DVD or CD drive is present. Very business oriented, but not too bad to look at. The model I have is equipped with a 6th generation Intel Core i5 and 8GB of DDR4 memory, which we'll find out more about later. The front side of the device has a power button, placed for an optional SD card reader, 2x USB 2, 2x USB 3, and audio. At the back, we can find PS2 ports, 2x display port, serial, VGA, more USB 3 and USB 2 ports, Ethernet, and again audio. To get a look inside, we can easily use the handle and lift the cover. Inside, we can see a 2.5-inch hard disk, the memory DIMMs, CPU and cooler, and 200-watt power supply. To start with the disassembly, I'll first remove the front cover. That allows us to lift up the drive cage and allows access to the cables connected to the hard disk. Once we got those removed, we can get the hard drive out. It is held in place with custom screws that hold it in this drive cage. Very easy to work with, at least as long as you have these correct screws, of course. Next part to remove is the plastic cover for the CPU cooler. This should help with the proper airflow. We can easily get it off without the need of any tools. Now to free up the motherboard, I'll disconnect all cables from it first. Starting with the other end of that SATA cable, which we took from the hard drive, front audio, front USB 2.0, power input, power command, and power output. Power for the SATA drives goes through the motherboard instead of coming directly from the power supply, as you can see. The front USB 3 ports are up next, power button and LEDs, PC speaker, and finally the P4 power connector. The mainboard is now completely free, so we can remove the screws that hold it in place. Before we can get it out, we will also need to get the CPU cooler off as it's fixed to the case through the motherboard. After removing the cooler, as is usually the case, we can see very well that the thermal paste is not in the best shape after all those years, but we'll fix that. At least we can get the board out of the case now. Before we take a better look at that, a quick glimpse at the power supply shows us this one has a maximum power of 200 watt. Sufficient for CPU, memory and drives, but pretty limited in case you want to put in a proper GPU in this machine. As mentioned, and as you can see, we have 8GB of memory installed currently. Then finally, we can also get the CPU out of the board. An Intel Core i5-6500. The specification sheet of HP shows us that this is one of the fastest CPUs available in this machine. In case you would like to upgrade it, a i7-6700 seems to be the fastest CPU that is officially supported. The i5-6500 that we have here is clocked at 3.2 GHz, has 4 cores and 6 MB of smart cache. In general, this CPU is still doing very well today, even though it is now about 6-7 years old. We'll see if the benchmarks can confirm that later. Let's take a good look at the mainboard now. First of all, we have the CPU socket, 4 DIMM slots with 2 slots per channel, power input MP4, power command, and power output for the drives. Then connectors for the speaker, front LED and power button, USB 2, USB 3, optional SD card reader, 3 SATA ports, front audio, and even USB-C, PCIe X16 and 3x X1, serial port, CMOS battery and system and CPU fan. One last thing I need to do in preparation before putting everything back together is to move the special screws from the hard disk to the SSD. These will allow the SSD to neatly fit in the drive cage. After that, let's take a look at what we have here. The motherboard, CPU and cooler, SSD and 4x4 GB of DDR4 memory. Let's put all of this back together and I'll be starting with the CPU, which we can just insert in the socket. For the memory, as we have 4 equal modules, we can just populate each available slot. Not much more to do here, we first need to put the board back in the case before we can continue. Then we can get it fixed. And the next step is to put back the CPU cooler. Before we can do that, I will put a bit of fresh thermal paste on the CPU. Then we're good to put the cooler back and get it fixed as well. We also shouldn't forget to get it connected. And while we're doing that anyway, let's also connect the front ports and power to the board. The P4 connector is guided through the plastic fan duct, so I'll also put that one back while we're here. In preparation to install the SSD, I'm connecting a SATA cable, and after also connecting power for the SATA drives, we can go ahead and insert the SSD in the drive cage. As you can see, it goes from the bottom up as there is room for an additional 3.5 drive on top of it. Connecting the other end of the cables to the drive is the last step. That's all it takes. After all, there aren't that much components in this PC. We are good here and can close up the case. First, I'll put the front panel back in place and then we can also close it up completely. Time to check if we didn't break anything with all of this and see if the upgrades were actually successful. There is nothing on the SSD, so we can't really boot the PC, but that's all as expected. Let's have a look at the BIOS first. System information here shows us that this is indeed an HP ProDesk 600 G2 SFF with an i5-6500 as CPU and now 16GB of RAM in 4 modules. That's what we expected and wanted to see. Now, let me quickly install Windows 11 so we can have a better look and do some benchmarks. The installation went pretty fast, and I'll also install all updates, for Windows itself, but also for the drivers that are missing. All good now, and let's start by having a look at about this PC. Again, no surprises here. The CPU is there as expected, and we see the 16GB of RAM. Same thing as in Task Manager, obviously. Let's bring in Geekbench 5 and start the first benchmark. Nicely over 3000. That's a proper result and, as I already mentioned, indicates that this CPU is not bad at all, even if you compare it with current newer generation Intel Core CPUs. You can also see that performance is near identical with the Lenovo M900 that I did a video on recently. It has the same CPU after all. Time to test the SSD. The numbers here are not bad as well. It's of course not comparable with an NVMe drive obviously, but still in comparison with the original 2.5-inch drive, a world of difference. Final test that I typically do is Browser Bench. $145 here. I'm not complaining at all, and this is more than I expected. That's it for this video. This machine, although not the newest, still does the job more than fine for daily usage. With a video card upgrade, you could even get pretty decent game performance in Full HD. Unfortunately, the small form factor and power supply limits you to low profile and low energy cards. But all in all, still a pleasure to work with this nice PC. Thanks a lot for watching. If you have liked this video, leave me a like, and if you want to see more of the same, feel free to subscribe. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.